news. Thanks for your company on the Daily Edition and a very, very warm welcome to my returning co-host, Tom Williams.
Thanks, Sal. Hi, everybody. It's great to be back. And it's great to be out of the house.
It's very nice to have you back, Tommy. Coming up for you this afternoon, small screen legend Frankie J. Holden is live with a special message for you at home.
But first, let's check the headlines from the 7 newsroom. Here's Angela Cox.
Thank you, Tom. Good afternoon. An 80-year-old man has died from coronavirus in Victoria, bringing that state's death toll to 20. There's been 20 new cases in Victoria in the past 24 hours, including 9 found in routine testing. A new site at Melbourne Showgrounds is among many testing sites set up across the city. Others are in Chadstone and Northland.
I was very concerned a week ago that those numbers of 10 community cases would be 20 by now. I think it's a testament to our contact tracing efforts and the 24/7 work that's going on that we've managed to keep that number stable.
3 of the new cases are still under investigation. New South Wales has recorded 10 new cases of COVID-19, but all of them are returned travellers in hotel quarantine. Premier Gladys Berejiklian is still ruling out a hard border with Victoria. Miley Hogan reports.
The New South Wales Premier has reinforced her advice to residents that they should not be mixing with people from Melbourne. Further to that, people from Melbourne have been told to stay out of New South Wales. Authorities have told businesses that they should not be interacting with people from Melbourne and that hotels, ski resorts, pubs and clubs can and should refuse service to people who ignore that travel advice. Health authorities are concerned that visitors from south of the border will bring the virus into New South Wales. And at this stage, health authorities do have a good handle on community transmission here in this state, and they do not want to lose control of that, warning that that could change very quickly if people become complacent.
And what's happened in Victoria could happen here. It could happen anywhere around the nation. It's that volatile because the virus is extremely contagious and it only takes a couple of people to unintentionally spread it to others for it to really take hold.
The Premier has said that her government is not considering closing the borders between Victoria and New South Wales, saying that it would be very difficult for communities like Albury and Wodonga. So at this stage, the borders will stay open.
Life will almost return to normal in South Australia from next week, with the state moving to stage 3 restrictions. Pubs will be allowed to have 1 person for every 2 square metres. Up to 25,000 people will be able to watch the football at the Adelaide Oval. But the Premier has hinted restrictions could be extended for people crossing the border from Victoria and from New South Wales.
We look to lift those borders on the 20th of July. Obviously, we're looking very carefully at what's happening in Victoria at the moment.
Right now, anyone arriving from those 2 states has to undergo a 2-week period of self-isolation. Tennis world number 1 Novak Djokovic has apologised after he was infected with coronavirus along with his wife and 3 other international players. Djokovic admitted the Adria tournament came too soon after the COVID-19 outbreak and he urged anyone there to be tested. Sarah Greenault reports.
Well, the world number 1 was the organiser, the face of the Adria Tour, and he's now been left pretty red-faced after becoming one of several tennis players to contract COVID-19. The charity tournament started in Serbia, then moved to Croatia, and due to restrictions easing in those Balkan countries, there was very little social distancing happening. Players were mingling with fans, playing basketball. They even went out clubbing. In addition to Novak Djokovic, some of the other players to be infected include Borna Coric, Grigor Dimitrov, Viktor Troicki and his pregnant wife. Djokovic has released a statement saying, "We organised the tournament when the virus has weakened, believing the conditions for hosting the tour had been met. Unfortunately, this virus is still present and it is a new reality we are learning to cope and live with." Aussie Nick Kyrgios had already criticised the decision for the tournament to go ahead, calling the decision boneheaded. He has come out in light of this latest development, saying, "Prayers up to all the players that have contracted COVID-19. Don't at me for anything I've done that has been irresponsible or classified as stupidity. This takes the cake." Wimbledon was due to start here this week, but for now the professional circuit remains suspended. The plan is for Grand Slam tennis to return at the US Open in August. Players just hope this debacle doesn't impact that. Back in April, Djokovic reiterated that he is an anti-vaxxer and said he won't be getting a jab, even if it becomes compulsory to play.
Family and friends of a 15-year-old Melbourne boy who was stabbed to death will commemorate his life at a funeral tonight and burial tomorrow. In an exclusive interview with Nathan Templeton, his family said they forgive their son's killers.
Solomon Taflingaki's mum and dad, Solome and Artu, have paid tribute to their 15-year-old son who was stabbed to death in this car park last week, saying he was kind, gentle and popular. In all, six teenagers between 13 and 16 have been charged with affray over the incident, but no one yet has been charged with murder. Solo's parents say they forgive his killers and they have begged Solo's mates not to seek revenge.
To stop here. I don't want other family to be going through the same thing that we are coming through. To stop it.
We also interviewed Solo's best mate Kiedis and Kiedis's mother, who admit Solo had previously had an altercation with a boy in the area, but they insist he was not a member of a gang, and they say Solo died a hero trying to protect Kiedis's younger brother.
I saw him, he looked really disoriented and he looked like he was gonna fall and faint. Kiedis checked his blazer and said, "Mum, he's been stabbed." I was holding Solo's hand and I was trying to keep him conscious.
Are you worried there's going to be more trouble now?
Yeah, I'm not gonna say that I'm not. But I believe that Solo, after Solo's incident, he opened everyone's eyes towards gang violence and that this stuff should stop.
Solo's family will hold a funeral service this evening before his burial tomorrow.
In breaking news, the Victoria government has requested assistance from the Australian Defence Force and other states as it deals with the spike in cases of COVID-19. A government spokesperson says the additional support will help with increased rapid testing, identifying hotspots and reinforcing the message to Victorians to stay home if unwell. It comes as Woolworths has reinstated a purchase limit of two items on toilet paper, hand sanitizer, paper towel, flour, sugar, pasta, mince, UHT milk, eggs and rice across its Victorian stores this afternoon. The preventative measure is in response to an increase in panic buying over the past 24 hours. A driver has narrowly avoided injury when a water main burst underneath a road in Turkey. It happened at Bodrum on the Mediterranean coast. They managed to stop just in time and reverse before their car was engulfed. It's not known if it's also a result of the wild weather in the region. And guys, I'll be back later in the show with more news.
Terrific, Ange. Thanks so much. Still to come for you this afternoon, we're live with TV legend Frankie J. Holden. Why he's sticking up for our ailing tourism industry. And it couldn't be more personal.
Next up, though, dinosaurs are ruling the earth again. Find out why the original Jurassic Park movie is still setting records 27 years since it was first released. More of the Daily Edition in just a moment.
Bill Cosby has been granted the right to appeal against his sexual assault conviction. Peter Ford, our entertainment editor, is here. Pete, what do we know?
Well, he's been in prison for almost 2 years, and we certainly know that he's wanted to get out since day one. So what has happened now? And he's been successful in doing this. It doesn't mean he's getting out of prison, but it does mean there will be questions asked in an inquiry as to why two things were allowed to happen during his case. Number one, why it was that the jury were allowed to be told that he had previously admitted to giving quaaludes, drugs, to women and drugging them and sexually assaulting them. He had admitted to that in times gone by, but the jury, they now say, should not have been told that. So that's the main thing that they'll be looking at. And also, why five other accusers who were not their allegations were not being tested, but why five other accusers were allowed to come in and give testimony to present a pattern of behaviour. Was that appropriate, even though it was not relevant to this actual case that he ended up going to prison for? So his wife, Camille, she's really been out there banging the drum, trying to get him out of prison since day one. She has spoken about the fact that she's hopeful that maybe this could be a turning point. Here she is.
My first reaction is hopefulness, possibilities now. Finally, there is a court, the state's highest court, that has said, wait a minute, there are some problems here. They can be considered for an appeal. I'm very, very pleased. It's not 100%, but now I'm looking at something that is possible for vindication. That is the goal.
So he's 82 years old. The bottom line is he doesn't want to die in prison. And that's what Camille is hoping. This could be a point where they can get him out.
Yeah. Tributes are pouring in for Australian musical theatre icon Michael Fowson, Pete.
Look who's back in town. Tom Williams, lovely to see you. Very nice to have you back, Tom.
Thank you, mate.
Sad news, though. Michael Fowson, this news has really rocked the theatre world today because Michael was one of the really bright lights of the theatre world, somebody who really thought was just going to be around forever doing things. I guess his big breakthrough role was We Will Rock You. That's going back now, and he was great in that. But this was a show he put together called Swing on This, kind of a Rat Pack type show, made a lot of money on the convention circuit there and corporate circuit. And yeah, he only a year ago, almost to the day actually, he got diagnosed with this very rare form of cancer, and last night he died at the age of 48. And some of it he's detailed on his social media through the last 12 months, and even in his darkest moments, even when he was obviously doing it tough, he still managed to smile. So the theatre world is very sad. He was right here on this program about 18 months ago, the last big musical that he was in. You can see his lovely wife Jane there, and we send our condolences to her and all of the family. And so 18 months ago he was in the show doing the show to promote Evita, which he was about to go into rehearsals for with Tina Arena. He was playing the role of McGeldy, and you can see in this grab that he absolutely had such passion for live theatre.
You couldn't dream to be in such a wonderful production as this. It was a childhood favourite of mine, so when the opportunity came up to be a part of it, of course I leapt at it, and I think everybody did.
So there you go. We take our hats off today to Michael Fowson, gone too soon.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the nicest guests we've had, and our love to his family. Pete, Jurassic Park has roared its way back into the headlines.
Well, everything old is new again, a bit like you coming back, Tom, right? So what's happened is almost 30 years down the track, and the original Jurassic Park movie has come in at number one at the box office, right? Kind of by default, though, we have to admit, because there are no cinemas open, or very few, and there are drive-ins open. So what the drive-ins are doing are basically getting out old, classic, great drive-in movies, and Jurassic Park is one of those. So for the last week or so, Jurassic Park has just come in at number one, pulling in about $500 million at the box office, which, to be honest, is not a massive amount for all of America, but nonetheless, they can claim it and they can own it. Yeah. And number two, actually not far behind, was the original Jaws movie. So good old-fashioned classic drive-in movies.
That's terrific. Great idea. Thank you, Pete.
All right. Thank you, Pete. Thanks, Pete. No doubt more jibes coming your way towards me over the next couple of days. Coming up...
Good on you. Thanks, Poppy.
The piece of 90s memorabilia with a six-figure price tag. We'll tell you what it is right after this.
Hey, Grace, while I'm here picking up some shampoo and conditioner, I was wondering what other specials you might have.
For everything beauty and more, follow me. It's time for What's On in the Warehouse. What's on
in the warehouse? The Gotcha for Life Foundation is dedicated to building the mental fitness of all Australians. They believe that starting meaningful conversations by developing strong social and emotional connections.
You too can support Gotcha for Life by purchasing certain products right now from Chemist Warehouse.
Throughout June, proceeds from sales across the Head & Shoulders, Codral, Benadryl and Sudafed ranges will be donated to Gotcha for Life.
Lynx and L'Oreal Men Expert are getting behind this great cause, with proceeds from their sales $1,000 donated to the foundation.
100% of donations raised in Chemist Warehouse stores will go towards implementing mental health workshops around Australia.
To find out more about the workshops Gotcha for Life is helping to fund, please head to their website. CeraVe is the only brand to contain three essential ceramides that help to moisturise and strengthen your skin's natural protective barrier, locking in the moisture for 24-hour hydration. Ceramides are important to help retain moisture within the skin and actually make up 50% of the skin's natural barrier. When ceramide levels are low, the skin barrier is compromised, allowing moisture to escape from the skin and external aggressors to penetrate, which can lead to drier, more irritating skin. This unique combination of ceramides is released to the skin by patented MVE technology.
And what does this MVE technology do?
It delivers these ceramides and other active ingredients, such as hyaluronic acid, through a slow-release technology to keep the skin hydrated for 24 hours. The cleanser is non-foaming and cleanses without overstripping the skin. The cream is non-greasy and absorbs quickly, and the lotion has a beautiful lightweight texture. As well as the ceramides, the hyaluronic acid in the formula also helps the skin to retain moisture. Right now, you can get 20% off the entire CeraVe range, but only at Chemist Warehouse. The Elucent anti-aging range combines the visible wrinkle reduction qualities of alpha hydroxy acids and the beautifying properties of a select blend of vitamins. 86% of women said their skin felt rehydrated after 7 days. 90% of women saw an improvement in skin smoothness after 14 days. And 90% of women said their skin looked rejuvenated after 21 days. Packed with AHAs to help with the natural rejuvenation process, vitamin B3 to help improve skin tone, and vitamin E for improved elasticity, this range has the tools to build beautiful, visibly younger looking skin.
Elucent anti-aging range starts from just $20.99. Shop in store or online at chemistwarehouse.com.au. Bye.
When was the last time you sorted out that third drawdown, Sal?
Oh, not 1984, maybe? Okay. I try never to look in there.
Yeah,
why?
All right. Well, it might be worth taking another look for some hidden gems like this ultra-rare Pokemon card, which is expected to fetch up to $144,000 at auction.
Wow, that's big money there. Pokemon Super Secret Battle Number 1 Trainer card is regarded as the holy grail of Pokemon cards. It's only one of seven that were originally issued at a tournament in Japan back in 1999. Now, still time to get your hands on it. The current highest bid stands at just over $22,000.
You'd have to be right into Pokemon, wouldn't you? Fork out 22.
We could go in together.
Yeah, we could.
No,
not that end of it.
That's it for you. One of our all-time favourite guests. We're catching up with the schoolboy teddy bear maker whose creations have caught the attention of the world's biggest names.
And next, Frankie J's fight, why the TV legend is asking us all to support our fellow Australians. The actor joins us live right after this. By your side, and dust from
a distant sun. Frankie J. Holden has lit up living rooms with his infectious smile for over four decades. From a place to call home to home and away, the Logie winner is one of Australia's most recognisable screen stars. But away from the rolling cameras, Frankie has a different fight on his hands.
Yeah, when he isn't filming, Frankie and his wife Michelle run a caravan park in the New South Wales South Coast. But business hasn't exactly been booming for a tough first half of 2020. So now the actor is calling on all Aussies to show support for our regional hotspots. And Frankie J. Holden joins us now live from his holiday park in Tathra. Welcome to the show, mate.
Thank you.
A tough start to the year really doesn't do it justice, does it? Run us through the battles that you faced.
Well, Tom and Sally, in Tathra, where the park is and where I am at the minute, we've had a three-peat because we had fires come through Tathra in March 2018. And then we had the threat of fires this year early in January, and all the tourists were asked to go home. And now, of course, we're in the middle of the COVID crisis. So this area has really copped a hammering. And, of course, we're not the only regional area to have copped a hammering. The irony is that the regions have been relatively clear of any COVID. So it's they're safe places to come. Mm. In particular, may I say, a caravan park, because there's already lots of space in a caravan park. You must have at least 2.5 metres between each site or accommodation, and all the everything's obviously self-contained, and most caravans these days are self-contained as well. So if you are thinking of holidaying, a caravan park is a very good place to come, and it's great for kids. And the regions really do need everybody's support.
Yeah, they do. The pandemic, as you mentioned, forced us all into lockdown, so holidays were no more. For you and for your staff, how hard was that?
Well, it's been very difficult, obviously economically, but socially it's also been very difficult, and not only on the staff, but one of the things that is great about having a holiday park and living in a town like Tathra is you get to hear the sounds of kids and families having fun together. Mm. And that's, I think, obviously the economic impacts of all of this have been dreadful. But from a mental health point of view and a morale point of view, missing the sound of children and families being together and having fun, getting off their tablets, getting out into the fresh air, going surfing, bike riding, fishing, walking on the beach, whatever they want to do, that's another thing that I've really missed. And I'm very much looking forward to hearing those sounds again as we move on through these school holidays and on through the rest of the year.
Yeah, hear, hear, Frankie. I reckon we all deserve a bit of a break. Regional travel has resumed in many states, including where you are in New South Wales. How important is it that we support regional areas right now?
Well, it's vital, Tom. That's all I can say. The regions, people don't think about it too often, but the regions employ so many people in small business in particular. And as we know, small business is really the lifeblood of the economy. And without the support of the rest of Australia, many of those businesses will collapse. And that will be devastating for the regions, which, of course, will only put further pressure on the capital cities.
Yeah.
I've been very lucky to have travelled extensively throughout Australia. I've been everywhere, man. And I'm still surprised, though, at how few people have travelled extensively within Australia. There are still people who haven't been down here to the South High Coast. I know people who've never been to the Top End, for example, never been into the Kimberleys or up to Cape York. A lot of people never even been to Uluru, which is, that's a tragedy. Yeah. And if you're one of those people, you need to have a good hard look at yourself.
Yes.
Because Australia is still, I think, it's a wonderful place to holiday and visit, particularly at this time. When you are travelling around on holiday, you know that you're supporting your fellow Aussies, and that's very, very important.
So important.
There's one I'm supporting there in the background.
Yeah, it's important that we travel within our own country. I want to ask you, Frankie, Queensland's come under fire for their very strict border restrictions, but we've seen, of course, now a spike in COVID-19 cases in Victoria. What do you want to see so that we can get back to business as usual?
Well, what I don't want to see is I don't want to see that I'm put in charge of those decisions. That's what I don't want to see, because I don't want to bag anybody who's making those decisions, because it's a very, very difficult situation we find ourselves in, and it is a matter of juggling priorities. But what I'd like to see, actually, is that for every individual Aussie to take note of the risks and the responsibilities that they each have to themselves, to their families, and to the rest of the country, because that's the way we'll do it. So if, for example, a premier says you should not travel into a hotspot, then don't. It's fairly simple. People saying that they need directions, well, you're getting the directions. So that's what I'd say. And I, like all of us, I've got a very positive message. We will come through this. Yeah. And I'm absolutely 100% positive about that. But everybody just has to take responsibility for their own actions. So here, for example, we've got a very strict COVID-19 plan in effect. In terms of social distancing, we'll have limitations on how many people can go in the water park at a time, how many people can go in the jumping pillow, how many people can use the camp kitchen at a time. But we can't be expected to be police.
No.
So we put the restrictions in place, and everybody just has to use their own common sense, and then we will all be safe.
That's right. We'll get through this together. Frankie J. Holden, lovely to have you with us. Thank you so much. And let's hope that we can all
thank
get
you,
this.
And may I... Thanks, Arlene. I just want to say how sad I am to see another great Australian show biting the dust. So my commiserations to all the staff and people who've worked so hard on that show over the years.
Thanks, Frankie. We appreciate that. Lovely to have you with us. Stay with us. We're back after this.
Do you ever feel weighed down by the ever-increasing cost of living? At times it can be stressful trying to keep on top of the family's expenses. Don't you think so, Catherine?
You are spot on, Jamie, and we aren't the only ones. In fact, according to the Real Concerns survey, 89% of Aussies under 55 are concerned by daily expenses and the burdens of keeping up with living costs.
I believe it.
Now, what if something happened out of the blue that changed everything and meant you'd no longer be there to take care of your loved ones?
What do you mean?
Well, here, take a look at this.
Okay, take care, mate. We'll talk soon, all right?
How's Nick?
Doctors told him there's not much else they can do for him other than to keep him comfortable. He said at least he got a full payout from his life insurance, so he was able to pay off the mortgage, which really helps out his family.
You know, we'd be in trouble if that were us.
Well, maybe we should do one simple thing and get real life insurance too.
Yeah, good idea.
Okay, now I can see why having life insurance is so important.
Yeah, getting real life insurance is one simple thing you can do today to make sure your family is protected, regardless of what tomorrow has in store.
Great.
When you choose real insurance, you'll have peace of mind knowing you are with a multi-award-winning insurer committed to providing exceptional customer service.
Award-winning customer service, you got to like that. So how do you apply for cover?
You just call one of the friendly team members at Real Insurance who will ask a series of underwriting questions about your health and lifestyle. Plus, Jamie, there is no medical tests or forms to fill out either.
Oh, that's good. How much protection could you get for your family?
You just choose a cover amount from $100,000 up to $1 million. Or if you are diagnosed with a terminal illness, Real Insurance will pay 100% of your benefit directly to you.
Gee, it would be nice to be in control of tying up those loose ends for your family, wouldn't
it? Yeah, that's what the benefit is for. Mm. Premiums are affordable too. As an example, a 34-year-old female could get $100,000 cover for just $1.46 a week.
That's good.
And with the real reward, you'll even get back 10% of the premiums you've paid after 12 months of your policy.
You got to love the real reward.
Also, when you take out cover, you'll receive a welcome pack in the post that gives you all the information you need about your policy.
Great. And let's say you still have a few questions.
Sure. You can call their Australian-based team or you can even talk to Real Insurance via Google Assist.
Nice.
You can do this on your smartphone, home hub, smart speaker, or any other device that has the Google Assistant enabled. Simply ask Google to talk to Real Life Insurance to get started.
Brilliant. Now, what if your family have to make a claim?
Well, Jamie, they can count on it being a stress-free experience because they'll be assigned a dedicated claims specialist who will take them through the entire process.
Yeah, that would be reassuring at a very difficult time.
Yes, and that's what the team are there for, Jamie.
Great.
So why not get Real Life Insurance now? It's one simple thing you could do to protect your family's financial security if something happened and you were no longer there to support them. To find out more, call 1300 729 234 or search Real Life Insurance.
Thanks, Catherine.
Nice one, guys. Ahead, shoe fly, don't bother me. We reveal the secret to getting rid of those pesky pests from your home or office.
But next, he learned to sew at home. Now his teddy bears have gained global attention. Meet the Aussie team changing lives one furry cuddle at a time. He's the teenager with a heart of gold and a house full of faux fur. Campbell Ramess has been making teddy bears since he was just 9. His adorable creations being donated to sick kids all over the world.
Affectionately known as Bumble, the now 16-year-old has created thousands of bears, raised hundreds of thousands of dollars for charity, and even caught the eye of high-profile fans like Olivia Newton-John.
And Campbell Bumble Ramess joins us now live from Hobart. Campbell, nice to have you back with us. When we spoke to you last time, you were self-isolating at home, but you're back at school. How is it?
It's pretty busy, actually. Got a lot of stuff to get back on top of and get back to normal and stuff like that. But I'm getting it all sorted. Yeah.
Good stuff. Hey, Campbell, during that time you did some online workshops for kids around the globe. What kind of feedback did you get on those lessons?
It was pretty good feedback. Everyone loved it. I was showing them how to make a bear, so it's all fun. They all really loved it, and they all made a couple of bears, yeah.
You've been making teddy bears for a while now. When you first started, if you look back, did you ever realise how much of a success this would be?
No, it was, this was my first one I made, and it doesn't look the best, but, like, I make these ones now, so I've done a bit more than I started with, but I didn't think it would get this big, no.
Oh, that looked fantastic, mate. Good job. Hey, you've always been a favourite, a guest on the show. We've dug up one of your very first appearances out of our archives. Campbell, are you ready for this? Let's take a look.
Giving flowers out on Christmas Eve and I asked Mum if we could... That was awesome, so can we take... We should have took some into the hospital for kids in hospital. And Mum said that would be a bit too much because she just shot for 9 people in the family, so we took... I said I'll make them then, and I asked Mum if I could use her sewing machine. And I made a little round ball, and it got to blankets, then it went to nappy bags, and then it went to teddy bears.
Oh, Campbell, that was in 2016. How does it feel
long
when you...
ago.
Yeah, when you look at that.
Makes me feel young. I was only, it doesn't sound like me now, though.
Trust me, mate, TV can age you in years, 7 years on, you know, like, let's not look back at those photos of me when this program started. Hey, Campbell, what's your advice for other kids who want to give back and do something for charity but might not know where to start? How do you get going?
You have to get going somehow, so don't give up on your idea. Be persistent and just go ahead with it. Don't give up. Continue. I didn't give up during my stuff and look where it's ended me now, so...
Yeah, you've been very persistent with it. Before we let you go, Campbell, I want to ask you, you've got a very special bear to show us.
This one, yeah. This one was, like, one of my first faux fur bears. It was... His name's Rusty, because you can see the kind of the fur. But it was one of my first bears that I made out of faux fabric that I... It's kind of a challenge to get this fur, I suppose. I went and got some like cotton fabric one day with Mum, and I saw this fur and I go, oh, I need this fur. And it was like $25 or something a meter or crazy like that.
Wow.
And I didn't have the money, just then. And I had to do some pocket money jobs to earn it. And then I took the fur, it was a big roll of fur, and I was just seen walking around the store in spotlight and putting the fur in the new like dress making or downstairs in the spotlight store, so it didn't get taken when I wanted to go back to get it, and it was still there, so like I'm happy.
You hit it. Very clever.
Yeah. Hey Campbell, you're making a big change to lots of little kids' lives, mate. I know you've got exams coming up at school, so we wish you all the very best and keep up the good work, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
You're Thanks, welcome. Campbell. See you, mate. For you, the Death Defying High Wire Act performed 200 metres off the ground. We'll show you those incredible pictures in just a moment.
Well, shopping for a new bra can be a bit of a nightmare. It can be time-consuming, hard to find your size and fit, uncomfortable and also expensive. Thankfully, my next guest is here to help. Great to have you back, Nikki.
Oh, nice to see you too. And I absolutely agree. Finding the perfect bra seems near impossible. Mm. But search no more, because the Sarah Mir bra...
Voila!
Is here.
I'll tell you what, it looks great and the fabric feels really soft as well. But what makes Sarah Mir so different to traditional bras?
Well, with Sarah Mir, there are no cutting straps, no more poking underwire and no more unsightly back fat. Now you can say no to bras that your body is supposed to fit, because Sarah Mir is designed to fit perfectly to your body. It's a bra so supporting and flattering, yet so comfortable you won't even know you're wearing a bra.
Yeah, it sounds amazing, but how does it actually fit to my body?
Good question. Well, the secret is Sarah Mir's double-conforming lifting straps. The lace strap is a lifting wrap, just crisp and cross, to be cradled in comfort and youthfully lifted. Sarah Mir also comes with adjustable lifting straps, so you get double the support, double the comfort, and double the smoothness, all without underwire. Now, let's take a closer look at Sarah Mir. Sarah Mir's lace straps not only look great, but they give you that extra lift and support that we all want. All you need to do is just crisp and cross. And you can even control how much lift and support you want with the three comfort levels on the sides. Now, Sarah Mir has 360 degrees of soft, breathable fabric and is designed with front and back cooling mesh panels to help you stay cool and dry. But don't just take my word for it. Have a listen to some happy customers.
I'm literally obsessed with this bra.
It is super functional and super comfortable.
Feels like I'm wearing nothing.
I mean, look at it. Love it.
Some great feedback, Nikki.
Absolutely. And Sarah Mir fits all shapes and supports all sizes. You'll look and feel Sarah Mir good from the front, the back, the sides, and even the straps, Kaz. And the sizing is easy. They go from small up to 2XL.
Okay, so how can we get a Saramere for ourselves?
Just call Global Shop Direct on 1300 134 888 or go online to saramere.com.au now and get your Saramere bra in your choice of black, white, or nude for the low price on your screen. But if you want even more value, you can upgrade your order to our value 3-pack and save $70. You'll get one black, one white, and one nude bra, and an amazing saving. And Saramere also comes with our 30-day wear it, love it, money-back guarantee. Put Saramere to the test, and if it's not the most comfortable soft bra you've ever worn, simply send it back within 30 days for a full refund of the product price.
Thanks, Nikki. The number again is 1300 134 888, or you can also head online to saramere.com.au and grab one or grab all three for yourself today.
Thanks, Kaz. Here's one for all you thrill seekers out there. A team of acrobats in Switzerland have marked the reopening of a ski resort with a series of death-defying stunts. Dressed in a black tux, acrobat Ramon Katrina performed a stunt called the Wall of Death. Just like a hamster on a wheel, Ramon walked inside the wheel as it rotated over the steep Alps.
Oh, those crazy Swiss. And if that's not enough for you, his daredevil friend Freddie Knock also stunned by walking blindfolded along the wires that hold up the cable cars, all at an altitude of 3,000 metres.
Don't do that at home, kids.
Go Freddie. The Matterhorn would be very close by there in the Swiss Alps. Yeah, maybe they'll go up there next time.
Please
crazy
don't.
Swiss. Still to come on the show, we'll stop by the Weather Centre for the full national forecast as a cold snap sweeps across southeast Queensland.
And next, has your office kitchen had an infestation of fruit flies over the lockdown? Well, our expert reveals how to get rid of the common pests and reclaim your airspace. What's next? Send me an angel.
We all know the story of leaving an apple in a desk drawer, working from home for a month, then returning to work to find an insect infestation. Fruit flies are most likely the culprit, with the pint-sized pest being known to be the biggest scavengers in the insect world.
But did you know that not all varieties of the species are the same? The outbreaks our farmers have to deal with are actually a whole lot different from those that are buzzing around our homes. So how do we get them to shoot? Professor Stephen Dogger is the Director of Entomology at New South Wales Health Pathology. Professor, nice to have you back with us. People often confuse fruit fly varieties, so can you take us through the different ones?
Yes, Sally and Tom. Hi and welcome, and good to see you again. So there's two main groups of fruit flies. There's those that are very important for our farmers, for the fruit producers. And these particular flies are about 5 to 6 millimetres in length, yellow and brown in colour. And most importantly, they can infest living fruit. So fruit on the trees, render them, basically damage the fruit and destroy them and render them inedible. And it can cost the fruit industry literally billions of dollars. Now, the other type of fruit fly, which we more correctly call either vinegar fly or fermentation flies, tend to be attracted to old fruit, rotting fruit, and things like soft drinks, old aged beer, and they can be a problem in the home. So the fruit flies that affect orchards don't tend to come into the homes that much, but the fruit fly, the vinegar fly, can be a real problem in the home, particularly if you leave old fruit there. And Tom mentioned about somebody leaving fruit in a drawer, and we often see that in lockers, particularly in staff rooms, where people could leave fruit in the locker, go away on holidays, suddenly there's this massive influx of these little flies. And these little flies are black and tan, around 3 millimetres in length, and they have these bright red eyes.
Yeah. Are these harmless or can they carry disease?
Well, they're mostly harmless. Fortunately, they don't bite like mosquitoes, which is another type of fly, but they're often called little sponges because they can pick up bacteria and can carry lots of bacteria from maybe something that's contaminated and then actually transfer that to your food. And they can carry bacteria like Escherichia coli, Salmonella, Listeria, nasty things that can cause food poisoning, lead to diarrhea, gut pains, and in some cases, you can die from these diseases. So they can be a real problem.
Okay, so what's the best way to make sure that we don't get a vinegar fly infestation?
Well, it's all about hygiene, ensuring that you don't leave fruit there to rot, make sure you rotate your fruit. If you've where you've got your bins, wash your bins in the house regularly, and also wash your bin outside. Under fridge, you can get an accumulation of muck and debris and gunk, and so clean out your fridge, remove the fridge and clean that regularly. Tins that go into recycling can be a huge problem to vinegar flies, and these flies can actually breed in the dregs of your tin cans. So always wash out those items that go into the recycling bin. And regarding the home, if you can keep your doors shut, ensure you've got good fly screens, that will help prevent the flies from coming indoors. Mm.
Stephen, if we did have them, what's the best way to get rid of them?
Well, again, it's much the same approach for prevention, trying to clean those areas where these flies actually can breed. And so the larvae of the flies are tiny little things, well, tiny-ish, so 4 to 5 millimetres in length, and they look like a little grub. And you can see these in places where you get a build-up of debris and dirt and old fruit. And so cleaning out those areas can be very useful. Insecticide sprays can kill the adult stages. And there's all these various baits and traps that can be purchased. And you can look at the internet and find some of these to help trap them. Old beer is very good for attracting these. And I see you've got a picture of a conical sort of shape. Piece of paper, and you could just put beer in the bottom. That'll actually attract the fruit flies or old fruit juice even.
That's perfect.
All right. Dr. Stephen Doggett, thanks so much. Some great info for everybody to keep those flies at bay. Thanks so much for your time.
You're welcome.
Stick around. All your 7 News headlines are coming up next.
Okay, no problems.
Time for a check of the 7 News headlines. Here's Ange.
Thank you, Sal. Good afternoon. The Australian Defence Force says they're ready to assist Victoria with the current outbreak of COVID-19. Defence Minister Linda Reynolds tweeting she will coordinate agencies to assess what additional assistance may be required. It's hoped the government's support will help with increased testing and identifying hotspots. Australia has recorded a new death from coronavirus. A man in his 80s passed away in Victoria overnight. It came as the state announced another 20 cases. 7 were linked to existing outbreaks, while 8 new cases were acquired through community transmission.
I was very concerned a week ago that those numbers of 10 community cases would be 20 by now. I think it's a testament to our contact tracing efforts and the 24/7 work that's going on that we've managed to keep that number stable.
So many people in Melbourne are now being tested that mobile testing sites are struggling to keep up with demand. The ABC has announced it will axe up to 250 jobs as it deals with a budget shortfall of $84 million. Some programs will be cut and funding reallocated to ensure the ABC is more relevant and reflects diversity within the community. Among the programs to be axed is ABC Radio's long-running 7:45 news bulletin. Two extremely rare leopard cubs have made their first public appearance at California's San Diego Zoo. The Amur leopard cubs were born in April and have begun eagerly exploring their outdoor enclosure after spending their first few weeks in their indoor habitat. The playful pair, whose sex isn't yet known, also enjoyed a rumble in the long grass. It's estimated fewer than 100 Amur leopards are left in the wilds of Russia and China. Let's get a check of the weather forecast now. 7 News meteorologist Tony Arden is in our weather centre. How's it looking, Tony?
Well, good afternoon, Ange. I'll start with the bigger picture. And the Weather Bureau has just declared that we're in a La Nina watch at the moment. The scale runs from the dry El Nino pattern all the way through to a wetter La Nina. We're just starting to tip into the blue side of that chart now. It's all thanks to cold water upwelling in the eastern parts of the Pacific Ocean. That's way out near South America. If that continues for the next few months, then we'll start to see weather patterns favouring wetter than average conditions for much of the nation into spring and summer. That would also mean a quieter fire season ahead, fingers crossed. Now back to the present, and it's all pretty simple. settle today. At the moment, 19 degrees and dry in Brisbane and Sydney. Cooler down south, 12 degrees in Hobart and 13 in Adelaide. Bit of cloud around for both. Onto the satellite, high pressure and not too much rain for much of the nation, though a cold front is lurking in the bite. It'll sweep across towards Tasmania and Victoria tomorrow, while that high will keep things settled further north. So onto tomorrow's forecast. A shower or two in Adelaide, a top of 16 degrees on the way. Melbourne and Hobart could also see a couple of late showers, tops of 17 and 15 degrees respectively there. Mostly sunny skies in Perth and also clear on the east coast. 9 up to 19 degrees in Sydney, and a forecast minimum of 6 in Brisbane would be the coldest morning in 2 years, but a mild top of 21 to follow. That's the latest weather, guys. More in the news at 4 and 6.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thanks so much for joining us today.
All right. Well, we'll see you all tomorrow at 2 o'clock when we check in with another member of the Daily Edition family, Chris Smith.
Excellent. We'll see you tomorrow.
Bye. Bye.